Nothing is moving in a circle. Each one of these dots is moving in a straight line.
Nice. Talk about burying the lead. That's the best bit.
Is that the best bit?
Yeah.
I want to show you an animation that I like, and I don't want to give too much away. I would like to know your opinion of this animation. So there are two yellow blobs. I'll give you that for free. I'm curious what you see happening.
It's kind of like they're rotating around each other.
Go on, say more. So if I talk about this dot.
Yeah, it's like it's drawing a circle. You know, it's looping around the other one. Or the other one's looping around it.
Yeah, it goes either way, doesn't it?
Hmm.
What I like about this animation is I've shown lots of people this animation, but they see different things. So some people see this orbiting thing. One is orbiting the other, but the other one keeps moving. Is that a fair description of what you saw?
Yeah.
Other people see straight lines.
Oh, I definitely see straight lines.
Okay, so there's definitely a straight line-y motion, and maybe it's obviously there and there. But at the same time, other people are insistent that there's some sort of circular orbity flavor, which is, first of all, I like because straight lines and circles feel opposite in some sense. I know there's a mathematical sense where they might be the same too, but both of them are seen by people in a naive description of what's happening. I ended up building an animation like this when I was at school because I was curious about what this motion actually was, and that's how I learned to program in Visual Basic. I've rebuilt this one in GeoGebra. I want to show you how I built it and also why I built it. You were right to talk about orbiting things and also right to talk about the straight lines. If I put these lines on, it's really obvious that one of them is going up and down, one of them is going left to right. But they always dodge each other. And I didn't make them move like this by putting the straight lines on. What I did was I made the circle around the outside exist. It's still not obvious to me how that works, but I made this point also exist. So this blue point moving around is how I built this file. That blue dot controls the yellow. In fact, the one going up and down is precisely just the vertical coordinate of the blue dot. It's just tracking wherever the blue dot is in a vertical axis. It's like the projection of it onto a vertical thing, and the horizontal one is just the horizontal projection. The reason why we see sort of a circular motion going on is because it's driven by a circular motion. It's possible that you saw something else, which was the connector between these dots is a natural thing to sort of see because it's actually always the same length, it's equidistant, and that's a fluke. And some people in their head are kind of averaging the two dots, and they're seeing the midpoint of the two dots, literally the average position of the two dots, and that is moving in a circle, which is really nice. There's a bunch of mechanical constructions called a Trammel of Archimedes, where you can draw a circle from two things moving in straight lines, and it's a mechanical way of drawing a perfect circle. You just constrain these two dots to move in straight lines.
I didn't say that.
A lot of people don't see it, but they feel there's something intuitively circular going on. So let me go back to the reason why I built the thing. The yellow points are the coordinates of the blue point. Let's just focus on the vertical one. What do you think would happen if I track the vertical position of that over time? Essentially draw a graph. What will that graph be? Next time we start on the right side, I'm going to track the Y coordinate and you'll just see a graph which maybe is familiar. Any thoughts, Brady?
Is this like a sine curve or something?
It is precisely a sine curve. In fact, it's not just any sine curve, it is the sine curve. And so I was a teacher for a long time. I was teaching people trigonometry. Sine and cosine turn up. And every single time I ever had a class learning that, they were like, "Sir, what is sine? But what is it?" And there are lots of answers. People think of it as a ratio, opposite and hypotenuse. That might be familiar words. Other people think of it as a function. It's got an input and an output. These things are true. But what I like about a third answer I'm going to give you now is that it captures both of them. Sine is the Y coordinate of a point moving in a circle. Interestingly, nothing to do with triangles. Despite the name trigonometry coming from trigonometry, measuring triangles, I think it's the worst named topic in mathematics. Sine is a circular function. In fact, it's one of the circular functions because there's another coordinate we haven't tracked yet. So let's just do that one. The horizontal one moving left and right there. If I track that going upwards, you'll only see the beginning of it. It's not going to be a huge surprise when you realize that it traces out the beginning of a cosine wave. And if you flip that back down, you'd see the cosine wave, which is precisely the same as a sine wave, but shifted along. It's just like the circle's gone round a bit. So sine and cosine as functions or as mathematical objects are precisely the Y coordinate and X coordinate of a point moving in a circle. That's why they're important, because almost everything that goes in a cycle or repeats ever, i.e. most things, are described by circles and therefore described by trigonometry.
Is a cosine wave very different to a sine wave then?
It's exactly the same. Literally, sine wave is there and a cosine wave is the same wave shifted. It's the sine of the other angle that's going on. There's no obvious angles, but triangles have angles and we use trigonometry with angles. So the angle comes from, if I draw the radius on from the center of this thing, the angle gives me a way of measuring where the blue dot is at any point. So the angle of zero there is the angle the radius makes. And that's where you do sine of an angle and it gives you a coordinate. And so the cosine is actually sine of the other angle. It's the angle between the vertical and this radius instead of the horizontal. And that's why sine and cosine are basically the same. I love the fact that seeing this move makes me understand trigonometry. There's not a triangle in sight until you put that radius back on, and then you can see there's a right angle triangle that's kind of sweeping around inside here. And that's why trigonometry is to do with right angle triangles. It's because x and y coordinates are at right angles and the radius makes the hypotenuse. But that means sine and cosine are like two aspects of the same motion. It's just a different perspective. And when someone pointed this out, I was like, could you draw it in three dimensions? And I was like, ooh. And I got this on GeoGebra at the inspiration of a student I was teaching at the time. So let me show you a three-dimensional version of this. So there's my circle I had originally. That's the view we had before. That's the same motion I just had. If I view it from a three-dimensional mode, I've got this axis going off into the distance. We're going to track the position of A, and time is now going to go sort of back into that direction. I'm going to project the point along that axis. I'm going to start it now, and you see that point going off into space. It's kind of hard to see without moving your head around in a three-dimensional world, so I can put the path on, and you can see, maybe not surprisingly, you get a sort of spiral coming out. And I reckon most people will predict that. But that means that sine and cosine are precisely somehow in that spiral, because they're just aspects of that spiral. If you look from the side, there's the sine wave. Which means if you want to see the cosine wave, you should probably look from the top or the bottom. There's the cosine wave. You can see it's the same wave, but it starts in a different place. And if you go back to the front again, they're all just a projection of a circle. And so sine and cosine are useful because they are the sort of compressions of circular motion in one dimension. And I thought this 3D diagram of that really helped me understand where this comes from. It does beg the question that there's a third trig function that most people know about, and I haven't shown you that yet.
Tan.
Tan. Do you know what tan is short for, Brady?
Isn't it tangent?
Yeah. What's a tangent? I mean, I'm in full teacher mode now, but well, I think you like, know what a tangent is.
Yeah, it's a line like going off, like grazing a circle.
Yeah, so tangent from Latin for touching. So a tangent is something you just touch the curve, it doesn't have to be a circle. The word comes from precisely that setup. This is a slightly more advanced file, I can show you all of the things. First of all, reminder, the sine function, and there's the graph we're building, and cosine is the other direction. And you can see the graphs arriving, tracing their way out. Tangent comes from drawing a tangent. But if I drew a tangent vertically to the place where we start all this motion, and I track where the radius line would hit the tangent, you'll get a situation that looks like this. There's the tangent line, and the radius line will always cut the tangent line somewhere, and then this green length is precisely the tangent function. It is also the gradient of the radius, because tangent is defined to be sine over cosine. It was kind of a huge relief to me personally that the word tangent wasn't a coincidence with the other definition of tangent, which is a line that just touches the circle. These three graphs are all related to a circle. They're all really geometrical things. They're not really to do with triangles except by accident because of the coordinate axes. And there are three more functions you learn at A level at school, which are one over these functions. So sec, cosec, and cot are one over these three. And they're also on this diagram. If I turn on cosec, cosec, otherwise known as one over sine, just like sine, which is a vertical length on this diagram, cosec is where the tangent cuts the vertical axis. And you see as sine gets bigger, cosec gets smaller, and then they're the same at one point, and then it goes back the other way. And so this U-shaped graph here is the cosec function, otherwise known as one over sine. And the same thing happens with sec, is where the tangent intersects the x-axis. And cot, one over tan, ends up being the other tangent across the top here is where the radius intersects that. All of the trig functions that we learn at school are actually all to do with circles, which is why they are called the circular functions. And I kind of wish we called trigonometry the circular functions from the word go, even if the use we most make of them is for finding missing sides in a right angle triangle. There's one more thing I wanted to show you. I had this diagram happening before where these two dots are moving. But you now know how I did it. I put those two lines on. They're kind of the projection of that outer point, the projection vertically and horizontally. Now, once I realize I can do that, I don't have to restrict it to two lines. I could put three lines on. You get a really nice effect of these three points moving. And they always dodge each other. They're moving in what they might call simple harmonic motion. But they're nicely sort of lined up so they don't ever hit each other. I just really like this. So I'm gonna just crank up the number of lines. Here we go. Now, what I love about this is that everybody can see the yellow circle.
And mind blown!
The dots are in a circle, definitely, but nothing is moving in a circle. Each one of these dots is moving in a straight line. So if I grab one with my finger, this one, it's just moving backwards and forwards. in a sinusoidal motion, as they call this wave-like motion. But all of them, because they're lined up in a certain way, create this lovely illusion of a circle rolling around the inside of the thing. To program this, you just need some knowledge of how to make a sine wave just shift around each time. And it's just a really lovely optical illusion I like.
Nice. Talk about burying the lead. That's the best bit.
Is that the best bit?
Yeah.
That's the bit that's got no use. But then I'm a sucker for things that have got no use. The thing is that I love maths because it's beautiful. It turns out it's also useful, but mathematicians usually do stuff because it's nice. And then they're like, oh yeah, it's also useful, but I would have done it anyway.
All right. You made me wait for it.
You know, one of the things I love about Brilliant, aside from their like deep dive courses, are their daily challenges. They remind me a bit of the morning crossword, a great way to kickstart your brain in the morning. In fact, why not test yourself? Do 100 of them in 100 days. All the questions and puzzles on Brilliant are carefully crafted to get the very best out of your mind. They often include little moments of interaction like these cool sliders. So here's a question. Can this line be positioned to cut these 5 circles in half, both in terms of area and perimeter? What do you reckon? Where could you put it? After you've had a go, why not go check out this whole related geometry course full of questions and lessons and proofs? To see more, go to brilliant.org/numberphile. The /numberphile will let them know you came from here, but more importantly, it will give you 20% off a premium subscription. It'll unlock everything on the site. That's brilliant.org/numberphile. Our thanks to them for supporting this episode.